Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. Somebody said Nehemiah again. Why? We're to walk with Nehemiah. You know, when he holds your hand and you hold his hand, and he said, this is the way I did it. And then he shows you the way, you will succeed. All the failure of the past, everything is canceled in Jesus' name. You want to rise up a little bit and then we'll pray together. Father, we thank you for this moment. We thank you for this hour. Thank you for our ministers, the singers. Thank you, Lord, the way they inspire us and the way they lead us to pray and to be attentive to your word. As you are blessing us, bless them as well in Jesus' name. We ask you, Lord, that this session you bless every one of us in the reading and the study of your word. And we pray, Lord, you so inspire us, we'll never be the same again in Jesus' name. Stretch us to the full limit so that, Lord, we'll never go back to our original position in Jesus' name. Help us to do more. Help us to go further. Help us, Lord, to reach people we have never reached in Jesus' name. Impart your very self unto us right now. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you very much. You can sit down. We're looking at Proverbs chapter 13, verse 20. Proverbs chapter 13, verse 20. The word of God says, he that walketh with the wise shall be wise. He that walketh with wise men shall be wise. And then the second part of that verse says, but a companion of fools shall be destroyed. You can render that second part as, he that walketh with the foolish will be foolish. And because of his foolishness, he will be destroyed. Let me read that verse again now. In verse Proverbs chapter 13, verse 20. He that walketh with wise men shall be wise. Think about that. He that walketh with hard-working men will eventually become hard-working. That's why we're looking at Nehemiah. See what he did. How wise, how intelligent. And see him, how diligent. See him, how determined. And see him, how he walked day after day. And then you come by the side of that man. He that walketh with wise men shall be wise. He that walketh with faithful men. Look at Nehemiah, a faithful man. Faithful to the Lord. Faithful to the work. Faithful to the people. Loyal, diligent. He that walketh with faithful men shall eventually become faithful. See him as he was just plodding on and toiling on day after day, night after night. He labored in prayer, he labored in building, labored in everything. And he that walketh with the diligent shall be diligent. That's the reason we'll come to Nehemiah again, because we don't want to just have a snapshot shot of him, just a brief moment. We want to walk with him. Want to see, how did he do the work? How did he organize the work? And the work the Lord has given us, how can we do that? Because he that walketh with courageous men shall be courageous. If you live in the land of champions, and you live in the land of the giants, and you live in the land of the courageous, eventually it will splash on you. Your thoughts, your mind, your ideas, you become noble. Because he that walketh with the noble shall be noble himself. He that walketh with the zealous shall be zealous. You know, when you're working with people who are zealous of good work, he that walketh with the passionate, that passion will come upon you. And he that walketh with the single-minded, purposeful people, you become single-minded and purposeful too, because that's your companion, that's who you're walking with. He that walketh with the single-minded will become single-minded. Turn it around. He that walketh with the foolish will be foolish. That's what it says over here in the second part of verse 20. It says, but a companion of fools shall be destroyed. He that walketh with the lazy, indolent, idle people, loafers. He that walketh with idle people, he'll learn how to be idle. how to be indolent. He that walketh with ignorance will be ignorant. You are walking with people, your close friends, they don't ever reach anything, they don't ever study anything. Study or reading or meditating, analyzing is not in their lifestyle. He that walketh with the ignorant will be ignorant himself. He that walketh with the unfaithful. You see, person always cutting corners, always exaggerating, always adding to it, or subtracting from it, and is never faithful or loyal. He that walketh with the disloyal, the unfaithful, he himself will be unfaithful and disloyal. He that walketh with the careless and the carefree, just doesn't care about life, about the future, doesn't care about watchfulness, about anything, is carefree and careless. He that walketh with the careless and the carefree will be careless and carefree himself. He that walketh with scorners will become scornful. You know, the person hears of something of a serious matter, he hears of life and death matters, and he scorns. He just scornful. And because of it, nothing is ever serious before him. You talk about heaven, talk about hell, is a scorner. You talk about eternity, about destiny, is a scorner. You talk about the prevailing situation today, and you talk about the peril and the danger of the future, and it's just careless and carefree. He that walketh with the careless and the scorner, he also will be scornful. He that walketh with the resistant. You know, you're talking, this person, before you even talk to him, he says, keep on talking, I'll never be convinced. I'll never yield to whatever you're saying. You might look intelligent, you might look analytical, you might even interpret the word, apply it to me. You might go into all the background and all the context and explain everything to me. But before you go on, let me just tell you that whatever you say, I'm not going to agree. It's resistant to the word. And he that walketh the resistance, he himself will be resistant. That's why you want to watch your company. You don't want to spend all your life studying Judas Iscariot, because he that walketh with Judas Iscariot will become like Judas Iscariot. You're not spending all your life, you're studying about Achan, about Demas, you're talking, thinking about the people that didn't finish up the race. You want to study people like Paul, people like Moses, and people like Nehemiah, because he that walketh with the wise will be wise. You are going to be wise. You know, when you hear this about Nehemiah, you hear it and hear it and hear it again. This wisdom, I pass it on to you in Jesus' name. You cannot escape wisdom. And wisdom will not escape you. You're going to have it in Jesus' name. Let's come to Nehemiah again. Now he's waiting for us. He's been waiting while I was explaining. He that walketh the wise. Nehemiah said, hurry up, I'm waiting for you. We're coming now. We're looking at Nehemiah chapter 3. Nehemiah chapter 3. I just want you to run your eyes through Nehemiah chapter 3. And you're going to discover something here. This is the kind of chapter that many people don't bother to even read or study. Because it's telling us, you know, Nehemiah chapter 3, it's telling us, this one built this, and this one builded this, and this one built this, and it goes on, and then these people did not take part in the building. Then it comes, which is another word, this one repaired this, and repaired this, and repaired that. And then you say, what are we studying here? Because all names and names of names of the people that built and they repaired. But you know what the Bible says? All scripture is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable. It's profitable for doctrine, profitable for correction, and for instruction in righteousness and reproof as well, that the man of God may be perfect and complete and matured, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. And because all scripture is given by inspiration of God, God has a purpose of keeping this Nehemiah chapter 3 here. That's why we're not escaping. We're not kind of overlooking it and skipping it and saying, well, a lot of names there, builded and repaired and restored and fortified. And because of that, let's just go on to chapter 4. No, there's a lot here, and I pray God will give you wisdom. Because this is where the rubber meets the road. This is where the work is really done. I've been looking at Nehemiah as was at the planning stage, at the drawing board. He's planning this and surveying this and going this way and going that way. Now he settles down. He says, men and women, we're ready. We've done enough planning. We've not done enough talking, enough strategizing. Now we're going to get the work done. That's why we're titling this Commitment to the Restoration of Lost Glory. Commitment to the Restoration of God's Glory. Well, you're going to find out, number one, they built and repaired the gates. They built and repaired the gates. Number two, they built the walls. I'm going to look at number one, the gates. Why would we be interested in talking about the gates? Because as you think about repairing the gates, I'm asking myself now, is there any gate for you to repair? Is there any gate for you to take care of? So that if we repair the gates, like Nehemiah repaired the gates, then we know that we're doing what we ought to do. We're looking at Genesis chapter 28, verse 17. Genesis chapter 28. And we're looking at verse 17. In Genesis 28, verse 17, here is what it says. And he was afraid and said, how dreadful is this place? This is none other but the house of God. This is the gate of heaven. Think about that. He mentions, Jacob mentioned two things there. Number one, he mentioned the house of God. And you understand why we say the house of God today? We're talking about the church. We're talking about our gathering together, our congregation together. We're talking about the place where we meet together, the house of God. Well, that house of God is the gate of heaven. The gate of heaven is not, outside there in the market. That's not the gate of heaven. The gate of heaven is not, outside there in your company. Where you're, that's secular. The place where we prepare for heaven, that is the gate of heaven. And if we can just tell how Nehemiah repaired the gates, then we can look at the gate where we are and say that now we're going to repair the gate of heaven. Because that is our own concern. Where people come in and then everything is repaired, everything is restored, and the gate is well open. I was saying that the brethren, the people who are coming, they get through the gate of salvation, through the gate of repentance, and they get through the gate of righteousness, and they walk in the way that leads to life eternal. There is a gate for us to repair. I'm looking at Psalm 118, repairing the gates and restoring the gates. We're looking at Psalm 118. And we're reading verses 19 and 20. Psalm 118. Look at verse 19 here. It says, open to me the gate of righteousness. I will go into them and I will praise the Lord. There are gates of righteousness. And the church better knows that there is a gate of righteousness. And therefore we look at that gate. Are people able to come to our church and then they see the gate, they discover the gate of righteousness and they're able to enter in? Maybe the gate is clustered already. Maybe it's crumbled. Maybe there's debris or dirty things covering that gate. And when people come to the church, they're not able to see the gates of righteousness very clearly and then go into the kingdom of righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. That's why we're coming to Nehemiah chapter 3. We're seeing how he repaired the gates, and we want to be able to repair the gates of righteousness. Look at verse 21 there. In verse 21, I will praise thee, for thou hast heard me and hast become my salvation. Look at verse 20. The gate of the Lord into which the righteous shall enter. The gate of the Lord. The gate of the Lord into which the righteous shall enter. This is the reason why we come to Nehemiah chapter 3. And we're asking ourselves, how did he work together in cooperation? How did he work together in concentration? How did he work together in coordination? Coordinating all those workers, number one, cooperating with all of them. And there was no discord among them. How did he coordinate everything? How did he cooperate together? How did he concentrate until they finished everything? That's why we're looking at the gates of the Lord and the gates of righteousness and the gate of heaven, so that we can have the appropriate kind of attitude and do the work of the Lord. Now, we're also talking about our cooperating together, working together, 1 Corinthians chapter 3. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, we're reading here from verse 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 9. It uses a particular language that will be appropriate for the workers who walked along with Nehemiah. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 9. For we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry. Ye are God's building. Ye are God's building. Ye are God's building. Therefore, we have something to build. We have a body to build. A people of praise and people of power and people of purity that we're building up for the Lord, for the glory of the Lord. That's why we're coming back to Nehemiah. We're saying, you did this before, show us how you did it. You did this before, teach us how you did it. You did this before, enlighten us and direct us in the way how you did it, so that we too, we have a building, we have something to build, and we'll be able to build a right. You'll be the right in Jesus' name. Can I just show you a few references of scripture on what you have to build in Proverbs chapter 14. Proverbs chapter 14, I'm reading from verse 1. You have something to build. That's why you are coming to Nehemiah. You're asking, how did you do it? Teach me, show me, instruct me, direct me, so I can do it like you did it. In Proverbs chapter 14, verse 1, every wise woman buildeth her house. There is a family to build. There's a house to build. There's a household to build. But we go beyond that. There's a household of faith to build. That's why we're coming to this, Nehemiah. We also build up the ministry and the work of God. I want you to come back to that 1 Corinthians chapter 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. I'm reading there from verse 9. It says, for we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry. Ye are God's building. According to the grace of God which is given unto me. As a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereon. But let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. That means then we're building the work of God. We're building the ministry. And that's why all these passages preserved for us, so that we will see how those who went before us, how they built, we will build as well. We're building a holy temple. We're building the church of the living God. In Ephesians chapter 2, Ephesians chapter 2, we're reading from verses 21 and 22. Ephesians 2, 21 and 22, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto an holy temple in the Lord, in whom ye also are builded together for an habitation of God through the Spirit. We're building the church, we're building the people of God, so that we become a holy temple, the habitation of God. And we don't have experience in building something like this. We've never done something like this. Oh yes, Nehemiah had never done anything like this before, but they don't give him grace. And then you want to now, if you know what other people have gone before you, what they advise us is, if somebody has gone to a particular place before, you've never been there, and is willing to take you there, let him take you there. And sometimes we'll say this, we'll say, climb on the shoulders of an achiever. Climb on the shoulders of an achiever. If you climb on his shoulders, and then you're able to see everything he has seen, you're able also to see farther than he has seen, because you are climbing on the shoulders of the achiever. And Nehemiah was an achiever. We're climbing on the shoulders of Nehemiah. I was saying, yes, we'll see everything you see, but we'll see farther than you see. That's why I was studying this book, which is Nehemiah. And they repaired those gates, and they restored all those, they restored them to the original strength, original state, and the security and the height and the beauty and the glory. And then it said they fortified the walls. Come back to Nehemiah now, chapter 3, verse 8. Nehemiah chapter 3, let's look at verse 8 in particular. Nehemiah chapter 3, we're looking at verse 8. Next unto them repaired Uzziel, the son of Ahiah, the goldsmith. Next unto him also repaired Ananiah, the son of one of the apothecaries. And then it says, and They fortified Jerusalem unto the broad wall. They fortified, they strengthened Jerusalem unto the broad wall. And this is the reason why we believe that it's a profitable study as a Lord for us to build your personal life. You build up your own faith by, you know, praying in the Holy Spirit. You build up your life, you build up your faith, you build up your family, you build up the church, you build up all that God, the ministry the Lord has given you. And then we're repairing and restoring the gates of heaven, the gate of righteousness, and the gate of the Lord. That's what brings us to this now, commitment to the restoration of lost glory. We're going to divide this study today, for this chapter, to three parts. Number one, God-given responsibility demanding the saints' concentration. God-given responsibility. God-given responsibility. Here was responsibility laid upon the back, upon the shoulders, upon the mind, upon the heart, upon the spirit of Nehemiah. And he concentrated on it. What has God given you? Your own God-given responsibility. And he wants concentration. He wants focus. He wants you to fix your mind on that thing that the Lord has called you to do. And then point number two. In point number two, we're having glorious restoration through sustained concentration. Glorious restoration through sustained concentration. That is, you know, some people can, they have a short span of concentration. If you give them something to do that will take about 30 minutes, they can concentrate. They concentrate for those 30 minutes until it's done. Stretch that thing to 3 hours. They lose concentration. Stretch it to 3 days, you've lost them. And stretch it to 3 months, you've lost them. Some people cannot concentrate on one single project for 52 days, especially when there are distractions and when there are conflicts and opposition and persecution, they cannot concentrate. That's why we learn a lot from this great man of God, glorious restoration through sustained concentration. Number three, great revelation for our solemn consideration. Great revelation for our solemn consideration. We're coming to point number one. Point number one is a God-given responsibility demanding the saints' consecration. Consecration. And let's come to Nehemiah chapter 3. Nehemiah chapter 3. I'll just select some of the verses to read. Here it says from verse 1, then Eliashib, the high priest, rose up with his brethren, the priests, and they built the ship gate, and they sanctified it, and set up the doors of it, even unto the tower of Meir. They sanctified it unto the tower of Ananiel. I want you to look at verse 2, pick up one word there, builded. Next unto him, builded the men of Jericho. And then the next part of that verse, next unto them, builded, is building, building and building. Look at verse 3. About the fish gate did the sons of Azaniah build. It's still building. And then you come to verse 4, and you're going to pick up the word, not building, but repair. You know, some of the parts actually need a new work to be done, a foundation to be laid, a building to be raised up. But some others just needed some repairs. You find repairs there, and then you go on in the rest of the verse. You see have another word there, repaired. And then you see have the third time, they're repaired. In one verse, that's in verse 4, you have repaired and repaired and repaired. You come to verse 5, again we're talking about them. It says next unto them while they take quiet, they repair, but their nobles put not their necks to the work of their Lord. And there's something we notice here, that in that particular tribe of the Tekoites, that the nobles did not put their shoulders to the work. They were not interested. They said, well, all about this Nehemiah and all this kind of zeal and all this earnestness and coming here, pick this up and put this one down, build that one, do that. They were not interested. But thank God, even though the nobles were not interested, the common people of that land, they gave themselves totally to the work of the Lord. And I pray that what they did, you will do in Jesus' name. And then you go on to verse 6, it's still the word repaired. It just just telling us this people repaired, this people repaired, this people repaired, but they kept the record here that they really repaired until you get to verse 8 when it talks about being fortified. And then you come to verse 9. The latter part of verse 9 says the ruler of the half part of Jerusalem. The ruler of the half part of Jerusalem. The ruler of the half part of Jerusalem. Look at verse 12. Verse 12, next unto him repaired Shalom, the son of Alohesh, the ruler of the half part of Jerusalem, he and his daughters. What are you learning there? Nehemiah divided Jerusalem into two. It's like when we're making regions, for example, and we say, well, this particular city is too big for one region over here. And we divide that just one city. And we say, this part west will be for this region over here, and this part east will be for that region over here. They didn't question Nehemiah on that. They didn't quarrel with Nehemiah on that. They didn't say, well, the city is just one. Jerusalem is one. How is it you are giving Jerusalem to two rulers and two region overseers? This one to take this and this one to take that. It will show you how they were just united. That everything that Nehemiah did, he just felt he was being led of God. And since God was leading him to divide Jerusalem, that was all right. It was all right with them. We shouldn't be arguing on non-essentials. You know, for example, if you take a very big city, let's say the city is about 2 million people, or 5 million people, or 7 million people. Do you realize that there are some countries that are not up to 150,000, not up to 500,000, not up to 1 million? And so, if one city is 3 million, I will say, well, it's even double a whole nation. And because of that, we say that if there's only one region of Asia that is covering this capital, because of the millions of people, we're going to divide into two, we're going to divide into three. And then you take this, that part west or that part southeast of the city, or this part southwest of the city is your own region, and this part belongs to so and so. No quarrel. We shouldn't be quarreling about, you know, all these analysis and all this management thing. Concentrate on the word. After all, if we divide that city to two parts, you still have about 1.5 million people. Reach out to them. Don't fight about nomenclature, about names and titles. The people here didn't fight about names or whatever. All they did is that they just said, there is work to do. We're ready to work. And they went to work in Jesus' name. Isn't that wonderful? I said, isn't that wonderful? When we're all united and we're not fighting over anything, they have decreased my work, I want to be a ruler over the whole of Jerusalem. No, that's not important. Let's get the work done. I've picked up all this. You know, there's no time for you to go verse by verse, but I've done that for you, and I'm going to tell you the summary of the whole thing. There are seven things you're going to find here as you look at the God-given responsibility. Number one, devotion to the Lord. Number one, devotion to the Lord. As you see all these people working together, no argument. They didn't stop the work. They didn't settle quarrels. They didn't settle anything. They just concentrated, number one, devotion to the Lord. Number two, decision and directives by leadership. Decision and directives by leadership. And the division of the city, the division of the walls, and the work they did was not in the hand of everybody. The leadership just said, this is your area of work, yes sir. This is your area of work, yes sir. This is your area of work, I agree. This is your area of work, and they set themselves to work. Decision and directives by the leadership. Number three, division of labor. Division of labor. You're going to find out as you read this number. In Nehemiah chapter 3, you'll see that this one repaired the place next to his house. This one repaired the sheep gate. This one repaired the water gate. This one repaired this part. This one repaired this part. Division of labor. If only one man, only one section is just grabbing everything and running helter-skelter, I'm here, I'm there, I'm there, we're not going to do the work in a systematic way. Number three, then, division of labor. Number four, dedication to their Lord. Dedication to their Lord. Once the work had been divided, they were not prognosing into what other person is doing or that other person was doing, whether this person is lazy or that person is hardworking. They said, this is my Lord, and this is what I have to report back. Because of that, there was dedication to their Lord. Number five, Demonstration of loyalty. Demonstration of loyalty. You're going to find out as you look at this chapter and you see how diligent they were, how committed they were. You're going to see the dedication they had and demonstration of loyalty. Number six, discernment by the leadership. Discernment by the leadership. Well, even though they wanted the work done in record time, that didn't mean that they just brought in every dick and hurry everybody that wanted to cooperate and, you know, work with us. They had discernment. The leadership had discernment. They said, no, you are not of God. They said, no, you don't have the spirit of the people of God. They said, no, you don't have the same mind as we have. There's that discernment so that we're not just allowing a damsel that is following after Paul and Silas. These are the men of God who shown to us the way of salvation. Hey, come on, you must be a worker. If you have that insight and you know that these are the men of God preaching to us the way of salvation. But you know, Paul the apostle was gripped in the spirit. She was saying the right thing but with the wrong spirit, and she wasn't part of the people of God. Therefore he said, "You must be come out of her," and the evil spirit came out. Therefore you must have discernment so that we don't just allow everybody to come in and get part of the work. Number seven is devotion, the devotion of the leader. Devotion of the leader. As you look at this whole chapter, that's what you discover. That's what you discover in that chapter, how these people, how they cooperated to it. Let me go over one after the other now for you to properly understand. Number one is devotion to the Lord. They said, we're doing this for the Lord. We're doing this for the glory of God. We're doing this because there is a calling of God upon our lives. This is not for me. He must say, this is not for me. I was well placed. I was doing my professional work. I was a king's cupbearer. But God draws something in me. There's the high and the holy and the heavenly calling. And it is because this is coming from the Lord. That's why I'm putting my neck to the yoke and I'm putting all my effort, all my skill into this. The same thing you have. You're not doing this for your family. You're not doing this for yourself. You're doing this because of your devotion unto the Lord. Jeremiah chapter 45. In Jeremiah chapter 45, I'm reading from verse 5 there. Jeremiah chapter 45, and we're looking at verse 5. Chapter 45, verse 5, and seekest thou great things for thyself? Seek them not. Seeketh thou great things, great recognition for thyself? Seek them not. I was seeking to be popular, don't seek that. I was seeking to be known, don't seek that. Do it only for the glory of God. That's what you'll find in Nehemiah, that when he addressed, when he gave himself to this, he said, I'm doing this not for me, not for me, not for me, but the glory belongs to you, O God. In John chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 30. John chapter 3, verse 30, it says, he must increase, but I must decrease. This is all devotion to the Lord. You're building the church, you're building the people of praise and people of power and people of purity, and you're building a ministry for the glory of God, and you're building and repairing the gates of heaven and the gates of righteousness and the gates of the Lord, all for the glory of God. Devotion to the Lord. Number three now, decision and directives by the leadership. The portion for each worker was assigned and recorded and supervised by Nehemiah and leaders delegated by him. Each section was built or repaired to the same standard to meet the expectation of a perfect peace. Understand that. You see, Nehemiah had the whole picture in his mind. There is a global picture for the work of the Lord. My brother, my sister, you are only involved in one area of the world. You know, my brother, you are involved in only one area of the world. And you know, you can so perfect that area of work that it becomes a kind of a different from every other part. And that, but a leader who is over all the various sections, he looks at the global picture, he looks at the perfect picture, and he says, this is the limit of what you are going to do. That's the limit of what you are going to do. That's the limit of what you are going to do. So that when we bring everything together, there is a perfection that is composite. There's a perfection that runs through everything. That's why it's very important that we give the leadership the liberty and the freedom, so that there will be direction, there will be decision, there will be directives from the leadership. Number three is the division of labor. Division of labor. As you read everything that you find in Nehemiah chapter 3, the priests and the Levites and the rulers and the merchants and the tradesmen and the families all took their share in this glorious work. You find a lot of names. It starts, for example, with the priests or the high priest, and then the Levites and all the other people that built, and then people from Jericho, and then those in Jerusalem, and those from outside. They all add their share and they build. And that division of labor is what gets the work done. You know, sometimes I have found some selfish people. Thank God that they are not here so I can talk about them. You know, if they were here, I would not talk about them. You understand? You know, they're selfish people. I didn't say you. I said, who are, what did I say? They didn't come here, so let's talk about them a little. You know, they're selfish people. They want to, they say, that's my area, that's my area. I mean, you know, some denominations are even like that. You know, there's a denomination there, and the population of that locality is about 500,000. And they have a little church there that has about 70 people, not even up to 100. And then another church, a gospel church, a Bible-believing church, a living church, wants to get in there, a Pentecostal church wants to get in there to say, what are you doing there? Don't you know that this is our area? We say, but the population is 500,000. Your membership is not up to 100. How about the rest of the people? They say, don't worry about them. They belong to us. This is our territory. That's why you'll find this one is, you know, Yoruba church here, and then Igbo must not come in, English must not come in. There's Igbo church here, and even if they are not reaching all the people that don't come in here, this is our territory. You know, the people like that, they're only fighting for themselves. They are not thinking about the eternal destiny of those people. There was no selfishness among these people. They allowed the work to be divided, and they said, you do your part, I will do my part. Isn't that what we're saying? That if you bring them in one by one, and I bring one, and you bring one by one, in no time at all, we'll bring them all in. We're going to do that in Jesus' name. It is division of labor that gets that done. And they had this kind of a spirit that got them united together. They saw that section progressing, they were happy. And then they saw that other section progressing, they were happy. They were not thinking, how is he succeeding when I'm not making progress? How is he that, you know, is commendable when I am not commendable? They just said, praise the Lord. Everything is for the glory of God. That's what division of labor does. Number four, dedication to their Lord. Concentration is an important principle in Christian work. The greatest results were achieved because God's people continuously bent all their energy towards their divinely assigned work. It is of greater consequence to do one thing well than to do many things indifferently. To concentrate on just one thing and do it well, and to be able to say, like Paul the Apostle, this one thing I do. That kind of concentration makes us successful. And then we're able to know that you made your mark on a particular area of the world. We're looking at Philippians chapter 3, and I'm reading there from verse 13. Philippians chapter 3, verse 13, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do. When you become a man of one book, the Bible, a man of one goal, the glory of God, a man of one word, the ministry, it's your waking thought, it's your sleeping thought, it's your dream, it's your vision, it's your life, it's your passion. You drink it like water, you eat it like food, you enjoy it, you have pleasure in it. It gets you on, and it gets you happy, and you are rejoicing that this is the work to do. And you're a man of one, of this one goal, and this one perspective, and this one ministry, and this one pursuit, that this is the one single thing you commit yourself unto. Those are the people that succeed. But the people that try this and they don't complete, and they have a lot of unfinished projects, they start this and they don't finish, they studies, you know, faith studies. They're just interested in a lot of things. You know, you see them today and you say, brother, what are you doing? I am in this section of the walk. When you see them another worker's retreat, where are you now? I'm in this other place. They plant the approach, they plant the approach, they plant the approach. Are you going to have fruit? But when you stay on one thing, when you concentrate on one thing, like they did in this in Nehemiah chapter 3, you will succeed. You have succeeded already. It is done in Jesus' name. Number 5 is the demonstration of loyalty. Isn't it wonderful? You know, Nehemiah, even Nehemiah himself said, when the enemies came against him, we're going to read that later, he said, we're on this side of the wall, therefore I have a trumpeter with me. And because when the enemy comes in that area and I'm not able to see it, then let the watchman there alert us, and then my trumpeter will sound the alarm, and all of you, you'll gather here. It means that he wasn't everywhere at the same time. No man is omnipresent. Only God is omnipresent. Even Satan is not omnipresent. That's why it says, I go to and fro, I go up and down. He cannot be in every place at the same time, but God is everywhere at the same time. And because we are not God, the leader, Nehemiah, or any other person, is not God, therefore we are not omnipresent. Since we are not omnipresent, here we are. And because we are here, and you are there, and he is there, and she is there, and he is over there, you need to be loyal. The vision you have been given, the work, the assignment you have been given, that's the reason why you want to be loyal. The demonstration of loyalty, they expressed their purpose to build the world, and they proceeded immediately to fulfill their resolution to build the fallen capital and to restore the lost glory. Number 6 is the discernment of the leadership. Discernment of the leadership. It was from the very beginning, even from chapter 2. Come on to chapter 2 now. In Nehemiah chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 20 there. Nehemiah chapter 2, from that very beginning, when the work was starting, that you know, the enemies came and they said, oh, we're part of this too, we want to build along with you. Nehemiah chapter 2 verse 20, it says, then answered I them and said unto them, the God of heaven, he will prosper us, therefore we, his servants, will arise and build. But ye have no portion nor right no memorial in Jerusalem. This man was a new man. He just came to town. But immediately he recognized the people that had a contrary spirit. That's not difficult to find, to pick up. It's not difficult to pick up when you're talking about the God of Israel, when you're talking about the holiness, when you're talking about righteousness, when you're talking about the covenant of God. You easily discover from the look on their faces, from the doubts they have, and from the words they express, you can tell it's of the contrary spirit. Is not one of the disciples, it's one, not one of the children of God. And Nehemiah could pick that up immediately. And that's why I said, when they said, we're going to build with you, we're going to join hands with you and build, I said, no, you are not part of us. You don't have any part, any portion, any memorial or lodge in the land of Israel, in Jerusalem. And we who are leaders must have that kind of discernment, so that we don't just allow anybody, everybody, to get part, to get part of the work. The labor of a hand was not accepted when not accompanied with the circumcision of the heart. Think about that. Their hearts were not circumcised, therefore the labor of their hands was rejected. Their heart must be circumcised, but be tuned and turned unto the Lord before we can take part in the work together. Number 7, is a soul. The whole is the devotion of the leader. The devotion of the leader. We're thinking about this man, Nehemiah himself. You know, there are some people that say, do as I say, but don't do as I do. You go and do the work. You go and you settle with the people and do this and do this and do that. And then where is our leader? We need something to be corrected here. It's not there. We need something to be supervised there. It's not there. And we need something, we need the master plan, so we will know whether we are building according to pattern or not. The leader has taken the pattern away and it's nowhere to be found. But you know, in the case of Nehemiah, he was there with them. That's the reason why you need to understand that we need to have devotion. Devotion, dedication to the work as leaders, so that we'll be examples to the people that are following us. We're looking at Nehemiah chapter 4. Nehemiah chapter 4, And I'm reading there from verse 19 all through to verse 23. Nehemiah chapter 4 verse 19 says, and I said unto the nobles and to the rulers and to the rest of the people, the work is great and large, and we are separated upon the wall, one far from another. That's what I told you. And it says in verse 20, and watch in what place therefore ye hear the sound of the trumpet, resort ye thither unto us, our God shall fight for us. I thought you'll say great gate, amen. Our God shall fight for us. So we labored in the work. It is a they labored in the work. What's the word? We labored in the work. We'll do it together. I said we'll do it together. While you do yours, I do mine, and we'll cooperate and concentrate and coordinate everything together. This work will prosper in our hands in Jesus' name. In verse 21, so we labored in the work, and half of them held the spears from the rising of the morning till the stars appeared. Likewise, at the same time said I unto the people, let everyone with a servant lodge within Jerusalem, that in the night they may be a guard unto us. He was still working at night, and therefore he needed security, he needed a guard, and then labor on the day. So neither I, think about this, neither I, nor my brethren, nor my servants, nor the men of the guard which followed me, none of us put off our clothes, saving except that everyone put them off for washing. That is, when they wanted to take their bath, obviously, they had to take off their clothes. And he said, that's what they let them. No siesta, no resting, nothing from day to day, from week to week, for 52 days, those people labored. And Nehemiah was there to labor with them. I pray that God will make us exemplary leaders in Jesus' name. You in particular, preacher, pastor, overseer, and coordinator, group coordinator, and sectional leader, God will make you an exemplary leader in Jesus' name. I come to point number two now, the glorious restoration through sustained concentration. And that is for the latter half of the chapter. That is Nehemiah chapter 3, reading from verse 17 all through to verse 32. What you are going to find there is a list of names. It still goes on to say, and this one repaired, and this one repaired. I told you about Jerusalem, that Jerusalem was divided into two. I read it to you in the scriptures. Let's look at this one again. Look at verse 16, for example. In verse 16, after him repaired Nehemiah, the son of Asbuk, the ruler of half part of Bethzor. Ruler of half part of Bethzor. You know, there's nothing strange in this, that you have a city and you divide into two. And say, my brother, we want to do this work in record time. If we give the whole city to you and the whole of that area of work to you, we'll not finish everything in record time. Therefore, accept this half, and then we're going to give the other half to this person. And sanctified people don't argue about that. Because sanctified people are selfless people. Sanctified people are unselfish people. Sanctified people, they are not carnal. Sanctified people are not fleshly. Sanctified people, they aren't looking for their own gain. They are not looking for recognition. And because of that, when we have to divide the city into two, you take half and you take half, there's no argument. After all, we're saved. I said we're saved. I said we're saved. And thank God we're not only saved, we're sanctified too. I said you are sanctified too. It will be unto you according to your faith. I said you are sanctified too. Amen and amen, sanctified church. And because of that, that's why we're not worried. Give this part to him and give this part to her, and we're going to do the work together without any carnal comparison, without any carnal judgmental spirit, without any carnal comparison at all. We say, this is mine, I'm going to concentrate on, and that is just, please concentrate on that. Look at the next verse there in verse 17. After him repaired the Levites, Rehum, the son of Benai. And then next unto him repaired Hashabiah, the ruler of the half part of Keilah. See that again. That's another city again, just the half part. And come to verse 18. After him appeared their brethren, Bevi, the son of Henadad, and then the ruler of half part of Keilah. And then you come to verse 19. It says in verse 19, and the next unto them appeared is the son of Jeshua, the ruler of Mizpah, another piece over against going up to the Amori at the turning of the wall. That means this fellow, when he finishes, when he came back to report, he didn't say, well, I've finished my part, and then the others have not finished their part. I think I can go on vacation now. Hey, the whole wall has not been finished. It's not accomplished yet. It's not done yet. When you finish your part, you come back and you report. You say, I can take more. I can do more. I'm available for more because the whole work has not been finished yet. These were people that really had a mind to work, a heart to work, and they really did it, and nobody was forcing them. We're going to do the same in Jesus' name. And there's something I discovered here. Look at Judges chapter 8. Judges chapter 8. Judges chapter 8. You know, you think about Nehemiah when he said, we didn't even put off our clothes except when we're going to take our bath, except for washing. You say, that man must have iron constitution. Not really, not really. You know, everybody gets tired. Elijah could get tired. Moses could get tired. Anybody could get tired. But it is not to give in to tiredness, because the work is still there. We're still doing the work. And because the work is still on, there's no time to be tired now. We'll rest when we get to heaven. A resting place, you know, you're going to rest for 100 and 1,000 and, you know, 1 billion years and 1 trillion years, just resting and praising the Lord. You're going to sing all the songs you never knew. You're going to sing them all through eternity. But this time is for walking. Not for holiday. This time is for walking. It's not for recess. It's not for, you know, relaxation. This is the time for work, and we're going to walk in Jesus' name. Look at this in Judges chapter 8. Judges chapter 8, I'm reading from verse 4. And Gideon came to Jordan, and he passed over, he and the 300 men that were with him, faint yet pursuing them. Faint yet pursuing them. Gideon got tired, but he said, the work is still there. Nehemiah got tired, but he said, the work is still there. And then all these 300 men following Gideon said, the work is still there. And because the work was still there, that's why they continued. You'll continue in Jesus' name. That's the reason why the Lord is saying, concentrate, concentrate. You have a lot to do. Concentrate. And we're going to do this work until we finish in Jesus' name. The word you need to keep with you is the word continue. The word continue. The word continue. That is, in the middle of the way, before the work is finished, continue. You know, sometimes you build to this level, you are tired now. But you know, this is rainy season. If you leave the work now, the rain will come and wash everything away to appear. You did nothing. Therefore, stay there in the rain, in the sunshine, and get the work done. Because leaving it is very dangerous. It means you are going to destroy what you have done in the past. Acts of the Apostles chapter 14. Acts chapter 14, the word is continue. You are tired, continue. Sometimes you are fearful, continue. Sometimes you are discouraged, continue. Sometimes you are disappointed, continue. In all weather, in all season, under all pressure, under all conflict, whether pain or pleasure, whatever, continue. That is how people succeed. That is how they succeed. Acts chapter 14, verse 21. Acts chapter 14, verse 21. And when they had preached the gospel to that city and had taught many, they returned again to Lystra and to Iconium and to Antioch, confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorting them to continue in the faith, and that we must, through much tribulation, enter into the kingdom of God. Continue. Don't let tiredness take the better part of you. You'll continue in Jesus' name. We're looking at Acts of the Apostles, chapter 26, verse 19. Acts chapter 26, I'm reading from verse 19. Acts chapter 26, verse 19. Wherefore, King Agrippa, I was not disobedient unto the heavenly vision. You have a vision to heavenly vision. the high and the holy calling. I was not disobedient unto the heavenly vision, but showed forth unto them of Damascus and of Jerusalem and throughout all the coast of Judea, and then to the Gentiles, that they should repent and turn to God and do works meet for repentance. For these causes the Jews caught me in the temple and went about to kill me, having therefore obtained grace, help, mercy, support, sustenance of God, I continue unto this day. He said, yes, I saw persecution. Yes, I saw danger. Yes, I saw the peril. Yes, I saw the Jewish people. They wanted to get rid of me. I didn't allow all that to stop me. Nothing will stop you. He said, because of the help of God, the mercy of God. He said, because of the sustaining grace of God, unto this day, I continue. I continue. You will continue. We're looking at Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2, we're reading from verse 25. Revelation chapter 2, verse 25. It says in verse 25, but that which ye have already, hold fast until when? Until I come. And he that overcometh and keepeth my works, not just words, yes, keep the word, yes, keep the doctrine, but keepeth my works unto the end. It says, this is not your work. And this is not any personal thing, your tribal work is not belonging to the missional work. He said, it's my work, it's the work of Christ. He that keepeth and keepeth my works unto the end, to him will I give power over the nation. That tells us then that he wants us to continue, and by the grace of God, we will continue. Point number three, great revelation for our solemn consideration. Great revelation for solemn consideration. Number one is for our consideration. Number two is a solemn consideration. There's something that you must not miss, and there's something you need to pay attention. Don't let sleep or tiredness get the better part of you. Now, this is solemn. This is serious. It's a solemn consideration. Let's look at, come to Nehemiah chapter 3, verse 1. Nehemiah chapter 3, verse 1. You remember what Jesus said? That the first shall be last, and the last shall be first. I'm looking at Nehemiah chapter 3, verse 1. Then Eliashib, give me the name. Say that again. Eliashib. Pronounce it conveniently. Eliashib. Then Eliashib, the high priest, rose up with his brethren, the priests, and they builded the sheep gate and sanctified it and set up the doors of it, even unto the tower of Mir. They sanctified it unto the tower of Ananiel. What's the name again? Come to chapter 13. Now we come to the final chapter of Nehemiah. Nehemiah chapter 13, we're looking at it from verse 4. Nehemiah chapter 13, verse 4. And before this, what's the name? Eliashib, the priest, having the oversight of the chamber of the house of our God, was allied unto Tobiah. Final chapter, the final age of a man. He started well. He led the way in the building, and he built the sheep gate. You know why? Because he was high priest, and that is where they'll bring the sheep for sacrifice. And because he knew, this is my area of work, they're going to bring the sheep from all over, and we're going to sacrifice unto the Lord our God. He called all his brethren, the Levites and the priests, said, let us build, and he did a wonderful job. That was chapter 3. But then, chapter 13, by the time you are getting to the end of the book, he went to become a friend, a sworn covenant friend of the enemy of God and the enemy of the people of God. And look at that as I read on now in verse 5. And he prepared for him a great chamber where aforetime they laid the meat offering and the frankincense and the vessels and the tithes of corn and new wine and of oil, which was commanded to be given to the Levites and the singers and the porters and the offerings of the priests, the place that was sacred and that God had already set apart for the singers and the Levites. He said, you singers, get away out of that place, and all you Levites, get you. I want to give this to my friend, to Tobiah. In the house of God, he made a place for the enemy of God. And this was the person that was the forefront person in building his own area of the gate. Let us watch and be careful, so that in the latter day, in the latter part of our lives, we will not abandon Christ and join up with the Antichrist. Will not abandon the true word of God and join in with the false prophets. Look at verse 6. But in all this time was not I in Jerusalem. You know, Nehemiah went back to the king, because he had set the king a date. He had said, this is the time I will go back. And to keep his word, he went back before the king sent him back. It was during that period of absence, the absence of Nehemiah, that Eliashib, the forefront, a person that was building, he went to join in with the enemy of righteousness. Then he said, for in the 230th year of Artaxerxes, king of Babylon, came I unto the king. That is just explaining that this is what caused my absence. I've been away. And because I've been away, this is why this Eliashib did this. And then he said, and after certain days obtained I leave of the king. He said, oh king, give me permission. I want to go back again. Then I came to Jerusalem and understood all the evil that Eliashib did for Tobiah in preparing him a chamber in the courts of the house of God, and it grieved me sore. Therefore I cast forth all the household stuff of Tobiah out of the chamber. Then I commanded, and they cleansed the chambers. Thither brought I again the vessels of the house of God for the meat offering and the frankincense. You know, sometimes when the reformer is gone, when the person who is able to contend for the faith was delivered unto the saints, when there's a little bit of absence, leave of absence, then all the other people, I pray you'll not be like that. There's some of these people, they change this here and change this here, doctor this one, tailor this one here. And then by the time you come back and you see that, they say, this is not the way the gate was. That's not the way the gate of righteousness and the gate of the Lord and the gate of heaven. That's not the way it was at the beginning. Hey, how did we put this? How did this come in here? I see that, you know, people having familiar spirit and witchcraft and sorcery and having all this contrary spirit. How is it they have become part of the workers and part of the leaders in the church because of a little time of absence of Nehemiah? I pray that our church will not be like that. Wherever we are, we are the kind of we are the eyes of the general superintendent, and we are the mouthpiece of the general superintendent. And whatever it is, you know, the GS would have done. If the GS were here, this side will deal with this. If he were here, this is what he will say. There's a commitment and a consecration, the cooperation and the concentration he will expect. And because you know that we are going to do the same, I always thank God that God has given us the same spirit here. I said, well, thank God he has given us the same spirit here. And you know, all this, it just amazes me that, you know, all these choir people, so you may not know that, you know, we've divided our choir to this area, this area, this area, and you know, they come in here, and you cannot see any difference. Everything is just wonderful. I thought there's a new anointing on our choir this time. I said, there's a new anointing on our choir this time. If you want to clap, clap. Praise the Lord. I'm just telling you, you know, sometimes you don't even need to preach. I can just release you to pray because they gave us the message already. But the point I'm making is, whether it's the choir from this side or care, we say it's above, excuse me the word, I don't know whether I like the word or not, you know, we say it's coming from that area and that area, but the same thing, everything is just perfect. And I pray that the same example we see from our singers and we see from everywhere, we're going to see all the sections of the work in Jesus' name, so that the same standard of preaching, the same standard of declaring the word of truth, and you'll not be able to tell, you know, those who are preaching here, those who are preaching already, they're not all from Lagos Central or Lagos Metropolis. Well, you know, the brother preached last night is from, you know, another place I don't want to mention, but all deeper life. And I just sat and said, praise the Lord for deeper life. I said, praise the Lord for deeper life. It reminds me of a particular woman. She was, you know, passing through a particular place in Lagos, and then she was hearing over the, you know, over the microphone, hearing the preaching of the word of God on a Thursday. And he said, ah, when did the GS come over here? I didn't know. And she's been wanting to see me for a long time. And so, because the voice was like mine, point one, point two, point three was like mine, and the PPP, he said, the pastor is over here today, I must see him. And then she got in there and sat down and couldn't see very well, because, you know, she didn't see the preacher. There was like a pillar there that, you know, blocked her view, but he just said, today the pastor must see me. And then they finished the meeting. After they finished the meeting, then she told the usher there, can I see the pastor? And then they conducted her to, you know, the person that, he said, no, not this one. I'm talking of the Gbagada pastor. And then he said, he didn't come. He said, don't deceive me. I heard his voice. And I had all the message. He was the person that preached there. He said, no, madam, is this person that preached? Said, what? I see it. Everybody is like him. Praise the Lord, you'll be like him in Jesus' name. I said, you'll be like him in Jesus' name. The unity, the concentration, the agreement between us, that when I pull it up, you're pulling it up. And when I say that's enough, then that's enough. And we're all cooperating together. And this solemn consideration that this fellow started well, he didn't finish well, you will finish well. I said you will finish well. Your reward, nobody will take away from you in Jesus' name. Because we're all called together. Look at Jude verse 3. Jude verse 3, this is the assignment the Lord has given you, has given us together. We're looking at Jude, and we're looking at verse 3. Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and to exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith once delivered unto the saints. We're going to do it together. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer. We're doing it together. The Lord has called you. The Lord has called me. And he has said, we will do this together. Remember all that we're learning from this chapter. Remember we're building. Remember we're repairing. And remember we're giving everything we've got, all our strength, everything we've got into this work of the Lord. It will be done. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord. Talk to the Lord. Talk to the Lord. Let the Lord help you. You build your faith. You build your most holy faith. Praying in the Holy Ghost. And you build your family. You build your house. You build a household of faith. Not only that, you're building the ministry, the work of the Lord. And you're building the temple of God, the habitation of God. You're building for eternity. You tell the Lord, I don't want to build in vain. I don't want to build in vain. All my energy, all my heart, all my soul, all my mind, everything I've got. Lord, I'm going to give my skill, my ability, my strength, everything. I'm going to build to the glory of God. Tell the Lord, all the grace you need is available. The faithfulness, the loyalty that he wants to see. Under pressure, be faithful. In time of conflicts, be faithful. Faithfulness, loyalty. In little things, in big things, we say the same thing. We act the same way. We emphasize the same thing. Build the gates of righteousness, the gates of holiness. That the people who come into the church, they will not hear any discordant sound. They'll hear the same voice, the same word, the same doctrine, the same emphasis. Following peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. Commit yourself to this work. Your devotion is to the Lord. God first. God first, not self. Devotion to the Lord. Seekest thou great things for thyself? Seek them not. Decision and directives by the leadership. Leadership must not abdicate their duty, their responsibility. Come to the forefront. Come to the forefront. Say, Lord, I will. I'm here. I accept responsibility. Put your shoulders to the weight, to the load. Carry it. Division of labor. Sometimes we have to divide a particular district into two. Why do they have to divide it? I can manage everything. That place is wide. We need to reach the sinners living in that community very quickly. Record time. Divide into two, divide into three. Make each district moderate. Sometimes we may want to divide the city into two. It's too big, millions of people. A region over here, a region over there. Why not? That's how they did it. They didn't fight against that with Nehemiah. They didn't quarrel. They did all that needs to be done. Dedication to their Lord. You're part of the work. Dedicate yourself. Faithfulness, loyalty. No worldly craftiness, worldly wisdom. Subtle disagreement, subtle alteration, subtle modification, subtle self-will. Demonstration of loyalty. Let our members see that we are loyal. He that walketh with the wise of the wise, let the people who walk with you be wise unto salvation, wise unto obedience, wise unto righteousness, godliness, and holiness. Not wise unto evil, wise unto compromise, wise unto subtlety. But they were teaching others. The companion of fools shall be destroyed. Those who are close to you, those who are near you, are they being destroyed? by your foolishness, by your unfaithfulness, by your disloyalty, discernment by the leadership. Know the people that have contrary spirits. Don't give them center stage. They ruin the work you have built up for decades. Discernment by the leadership. All those glib talkers, these are the servants of God who show unto us the way of salvation. Don't believe them. They have a contrary spirit. Get them out of that center. Don't make them your assistants. And leaders, if the GS puts anybody aside, even if you don't understand, don't use backhanded method of bringing that person in, thinking, why is this person in the cooler? He can do this or she can do that. You don't know. You don't know. Discernment. Tell the Lord, oh Lord, here am I. I'll cooperate with leadership, not fight with leadership. And pray that you will not be like Eliashib. Started well, built well, hardworking, committed, consecrated, submissive, yielded. In the final chapter, it was gone. Gone into alliance with the enemy. The false prophets. Gone into agreement with the enemy of righteousness. Watch, take heed, beware of false prophets. I come to you in sheep's clothing, inwardly the ravening wolves. You shall know them by their words. Do men gather figs, grapes of thistles? Can salt water yield sweet water? Sweet? Neither can they bring forth good fruit. And every tree that bringeth forth not good fruit shall be hewn down, cut down, and cast into the fire. Therefore, by their works ye shall know them. Don't be like Eliashib that started well on his way to heaven, ended up at the brink of hell. Watch, take heed, beware.